Faculty Research Committee, allow me to very warmly welcome all of you to the first in a series of workshops that the Research Committee will be organizing for the faculty. And we are extremely happy that there are so many participants, at least well over 75 right now, and still again people are still joining in. And we have a fantastic lineup of speakers. And so first of all, let me very warmly welcome all the senior professors, the professors, the academics, the mid-level, mid-career academics, the young academics, the early career academics, the research assistants, and even I have noticed that some of the special students also are there. So that's fantastic. So a very good evening to all of you and a very warm welcome. So without much ado, let me introduce you the first speaker. We have been very fortunate in getting Professor K. M. Nalindi Silva, Chair and Senior Professor, Head of the Department of Chemistry, whom we all know and whom we all are very fond of. And above all, he's a fantastic researcher, and he is a person who wins large grants, you know, in the size of 50 million and so on, and even bigger than that. So Professor Nalindi Silva is here to talk to us about tips to write a winning research proposal. I may also, if I may, let you know that this workshop is being recorded. The recording will be also made available to all of you eventually. So over to you, Professor Nalindi.
Thank you very much, Preeti, for your kind introduction. And I'm very glad that I don't know whether we have done this kind of thing before. I think this is the beauty of the research committee handled by a top researcher in the Faculty of Science. And I have a great respect for you as a researcher, Preeti. And it's very nice to see these kind of things, because it's very important that we motivate the young people. I was a bit, you know, when I called you also yesterday, that we thought that I asked you whether the people will be there. But end of the day, I mean, I thought, you know, there are 85 participants at the moment. Yeah, it's a quite a significant number, 85 is. You know, I thought that, you know, the only the interested people will join at any level of study. You know what my point is, this presentation, I am also a learner every day, because though I am a chair professor and I'm the head of the department, that doesn't matter, that I have long way to many things to learn. I look at the YouTube every day, I look at the MIT courseware. These presentations, I mean, if you have interest to learn by yourself, I mean, these are available. These slides, I openly tell that I took it from MIT open courseware. I mean, not exactly, but about few slides I took it, and I because these are, you don't have to reinvent the wheel, you know. So it is very, very important that you know where the resources are. MIT courseware are excellent resource for young people. I mean, you can learn by yourself, but I don't know whether you have the enthusiasm to learn by yourself. Normally our younger generation wait somebody teaches something, but anyway, it's encouragement that you have the internet is so powerful, and if you have interest, you can learn. But I will summarize. I will share my screen. And I will probably switch off my video a little bit. Okay, I will go to the presentation mode. Okay. Can all of you see the presentation? Preeti, can you see?
Yes.
Can, Nalin, can. Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, okay. All right. So I will address some points, Preeti, today. I mean, I am very bold approach, and I will tell exactly what our people are doing and what exactly why our people are failing, why we are not winning big grants, why the other people are getting big grants, like we can't grumble, Peradini is getting big grants. The reason is that we have to build a research culture first. And the senior researchers have to give a like an umbrella coverage to the young researchers to give the tips and the motivate them to do to good research and to support them in writing excellent proposals. So what happens today is writing a proposal is like, you know, I have been doing this research proposal. I was a chairman of research committee in NSF and for about 3 to 4 years, and we have been doing this proposal writing every year at NSF. And every time when I present, I tell, this is not a joke. This is not an easy process, writing a research proposal. I mean, what happens? I'll tell you frankly what happens in our system. I want to change you to think in a more nicer way of writing a proposal. When the research a grant advertise, for example, the research committee advertises our grants. You know, we advertise, give some time, you know, 1-2 months, pretty normally 2 months, 1 month we give, yeah? Okay, more than that, yeah? Pretty?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, so what happens is people start thinking of writing a proposal. You know, when this is the real scenario of proposal writing in normal context. When you see the advertisement, you have a hype that I won't write a proposal. Okay. You save your flyer, save this thing, and then you think about the proposal. There are some people who starts from that point onward. Sometimes some people wait till the last minute, about a week time, then all of a sudden you start writing the proposal. Those proposals are pathetic. Those proposals are not going to work. Those proposals are, I'm telling you, point blank hopeless. If you want to write a senior researcher like me or Preeti, I don't think we can write a comprehensive research proposal in 1 week. It is impossible. It is impossible. So that's the first advice I give you. If you want to write a comprehensive proposal, make sure that you spend at least 2 to 3 months on your proposal. Otherwise, it's not going to be a good proposal at all. I will tell you the reasons in my last 3 slides about the planning, because the project management, those are very important. That is why Professor Preeti gets always research proposals, extensions, deviations, thousands of excuses for deviations. That is because there is no project planning well ahead. I'll take an example of our 50 million grant where my wife Rohini was the principal investigator and the deputy principal investigator of that grant. I will take few examples on that and I will give you what are the main ingredients of a research proposal. Right, okay, now we will get into the proposal structure a little bit as a formality. Let me see whether it moves. It's not moving. Right. Basically, the research proposal, what you write is, what is your plan? You know, what is your research plan? You know, it describes your plan in detail. This is not a very easy process. This, you have to give a lot of mind time, a lot of brain time to your plan. And also, because you have to think about your study, you have to think about your reviewers also. Sometimes, you know, university research proposals are evaluated internally maybe, but I'm talking about NSF or NRC or big foreign grants. You know, I'm always pushing my staff to not even look into the local grants. You have TWS grant, World Bank grants, you know, the Swedish grants, you know, those are the big grants we have to win. For those things, you need to have because those proposals are reviewed by top-notch scientists. It's not a simple thing for you to achieve to convince those reviewers. So the essential ingredients are the research questions. Do you have a research question to investigate? That's the first thing. Otherwise, you know, I know people, you know, people listen to a presentation, you know, okay, why don't I do this kind of a thing? Okay, you get into the same bandwagon, you know. Okay, say for example, I do water purification nanotechnology using water purification using nanotechnology. Okay, you get into the same thing and you do a little bit of modification and you do some kind of research. That's also research, but do you have a research question? What problems does your research going to address? You know, that's very important. Research question is very critical, that you have to articulate in a proper way. What is your research question? What are you going to solve? What are the problems you have in this world? So then I will tell you how to tackle the literature review and to get into the proper proposal. Then your research design. How will the research achieve its objectives? You know, these are the three. This is really explained in MIT OpenCourseWare. If you have time, you just log into that website. You just Google search MIT course OpenCourseWare. You will find so many disciplines, you know, you can learn. And then your benefit. These are the three things, three ingredients in your research proposal: research question, the research design, and the benefit, significance of your research. So it's very critical these days. You know, I always rule out the people are going for, I'm a chemist, we are the chemist and the biotechnologist, the PDs, biotechnology, molecular biology, immunology, that type of thing. You know, those disciplines are related to product development and the commercial value, even the statistics, you know, there are algorithm development, you know, the plant sciences, new methodologies for bringing up new plants or genetic engineering or whatever. So every research has a benefit. The benefit that I will consider, as there are two aspects. It's very important as a faculty of science, I never inculcate a culture in my department to make products. You know, we have to distinguish this very clearly. If you are going to make a product, like say, for example, as a chemist, okay, I want to design a project to develop a new soap, new detergent. I mean, that chemistry is well established. The chemistry is well established. What you do is normally you manipulate one or two ingredients and you come up with a new product. There is no absolute science going into that. You know, you might get a product. So there is but at the same time, you can explore your fundamental science, and that will lead to a new innovation and new product development with a strong backing of science. That is what the major technologically advanced countries, like the presently controversial the country who is engaging in a bad conflict in Middle East, like I take the example as the Israel as an example. The highest percentage of Nobel laureates are from Israel, and those technologically advanced countries, how they develop their fundamental science is so strong. When you have strong fundamental backing, and that will lead to a innovative product. Otherwise, you know, we are like, you know, we are not like ITI or other places. ITI is designed to make products to benefit to the nation. But our scope is to give a fundamental science explore that will lead to a proper, really innovative product. So that keep that in mind. There will be, I have told my department, my junior people, I have designed a system where below 40 people get more preference than the over 40 people. I'm included. I don't get any exclusive rights in the department funding for any of my research. I expect our age, we have to bring research money. The department is not going to fund over 40, over 50 people for their research program. It is exclusively for the younger people, below 40 people, to encourage. Of course, we'll give more benefit to the senior people. But my point was not to misinterpret my statement, because it has been recorded also. But my first preference is the young people between 30 and 40. They are the budding scientists where, you know, they have those people, the ideas are to explode, not to keep it under a carpet. You know, we don't have much ideas now. You know, that is why we hire good PhD students. When you go up in the ladder, you hire the big guns, big PhD students, big postdocs. Those are the people who are. So we give the umbrella coverage for them to flourish. So they will. So this is the development scenario that I see in the faculty, and all seven departments have to work under this theme, under research committee. You know, we can absolutely flourish. I'm not talking about short-term goal, not 2 to 3 years, not 3 to 5 years. I'm talking about a 20-year, 25 years plan. You know, we will have a short-term goal, like simple product development, but long-term goal, we have to conquer our science. You know, that is where our research question is very important. It can be in our department also there are people who are doing absolutely fundamental research. There are no product at the vicinity. You know, some are doing surface enhanced laser Raman spectroscopy in collaboration with physics. Those are very high flying areas, you know, algorithm development like computational chemistry, some are doing advanced algorithm development. So those will not have a direct benefit as a commercial product, but this will have a direct impact on the landscape of research in the Faculty of Science. So this is very critical. My young colleagues in the department, in the faculty, this is very important when you articulate a research question. So research proposal, if I take this is very important, right? This is critical in these are very important that you the creativity, intellectual content, outline steps in your research proposal, and justify your research, think through your experiments, anticipate a realistic timetable. I will talk about the timetable very soon. Preeti, you tell me when I have 5 minutes to 10 minutes, then I can speed up.
Okay.
Maybe 10 minutes you tell me, right? Okay. Because you gave me half an hour when I start 4:10,
yeah.
Then probably 4:40 I will stop, right?
Okay.
Anticipate potential problems, you know. This slide is, you know, you take it, this is before you do it. Some people write a research proposal, halfway they write to the research committee and say, I was waiting for a chemical and that didn't arrive on time. You know, that's an excuse. These days, that's an excuse because of the COVID and, you know, international travel, international, you know, all these problems. But even a normal time, this is really a problem because I was chairing the NSF research committee, and also I was chairing the NSF technology committee also. As a chair of technological committee, I got about 80 to 100 proposals. Only two were funded, you know, because I knew even the research proposals, you know, these are very important. A good reviewer will look into all of these things because, you know, this potential, that's what you call, you know, anticipating means you have to think, you know, if you are writing a proposal for 1 year, 2 year, or 3 year, or 5 year. Our proposal was 5 year in NRC Mega Grant 2017. So you can imagine how you anticipate the problems in the, we never anticipated the COVID, we never anticipated the bomb blast in 2019, but all were taken care of within the proposal because of the contingencies that we have planned within our proposal. So those are very important when you articulate a proposal. So justification is very important. So realistic timetable is very important. You have to be very realistic on your time scale, because otherwise, you know, if you create a bad name at front as a young people, because I may be reviewing your proposals in the future, you know. So if you create a bad name on your, like you take a grant and you keep on postponing, you keep on requesting extensions, and end of the proposal, end of the research project, you find you have leftover money, over $500,000 left in your proposal, and the research committee will ask, why did you ask then? Then you have to tell that, oh my goodness, I have no answer for that. So it's very important that, so you can't have any money unused. You can have a percentage plus or minus, you know, so that's acceptable, but not a huge chunk is unused in your grant, you know. So it's very important that you give a real creative thinking in terms of the science, in terms of the resource management for your proposal. It's very critical, mind you. And I will not go through this a typical proposal. These are unique to department to department, unique to funding organization to funding organization. You have to get their template. You have to get the university template, and this is a generic one. I have just showed you the title, background, problem statement, aims and objective, rationale and context, methodology, plan of work, resources, outcomes, reference list. Those are the standard, but each and every one is connected to each other. It's very important you have a excellent flow of the proposal. You know, a good reader, a good reviewer will identify clearly if you have cut and pasted from two, three places and write a proposal, that you will easily see that that context, because the flow is getting broken. The flow that you start is something else you are telling, and also or some repetition from the same couple of paragraphs. When you read, you will see the repetition that shows that there is no coherence in the proposal. So it's very important that it will flow through like a river from title to the reference list. It's very, very important that. So it's difficult to do at once, but mind you, I'm telling you that is why you need to put your time. I will tell you why you need time, you know. So title is like a mini abstract, you know. The moment you see the title, the reader or the reviewer will see, all right, okay, he or she is going to do this. Okay, got the idea. So fantastic, you know. It will give a clear, concise message to the reader. This is what I'm going to do. You know, that's like a mini abstract. And then, some people write titles, you know, long titles. When you read the title, when you come to the end of the title, you can't remember the front of the title. So it's a very long title. So for example, our mega grant title was Advanced Materials for Water Purification, you know. That's something like that. Yeah, very, very short. It gives you the clear message. This is what we are going to do. This is what we are going to do. That has some keywords in your research. Our case, advanced materials, water, purification, all these keywords are included in the title. So it's very important that you so your problem statement has to be well focused.
Sir, we cannot hear anything.
Just a minute, I'm trying to call him.
Okay. We'll see whether the slides are moving. Yeah, the slides are moving. Okay. Okay. It's very, very important. I'm sorry for that. I think my Wi-Fi is a problem. Yeah, but anyway. I will just a minute. Now you can hear me, no? Right?
Yes, sir. We can hear.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Okay. The problem statement is very important that you articulate a very straightforward and very focused problem statement. I'm sorry when I lose the flow, the contents that I was planning to tell you. But anyway, I will try to get back to the normal mode. So the literature review is very important. Literature review is not just a summary of literature. It's very important. How to get the literature supports your hypothesis, and how critical. Because I know some people have started projects when they start publishing and they find it is already been published. That's the pathetic situation that you will ever face if you don't do a proper literature search. It's very important. The first thing that I will do when I take a proposal to review, I do a Google search. Most of the time, there are similar proposals, fine, but I know there is a difference. But the researcher is not in a position to tell exactly the difference between the published or the other work, and this work. So it is very critical that you address that. It's like, you know, good literature review, like you introduce the field first, then focus on certain aspects in the field of interest, and then you end with the gap analysis. So it's very important. When you start the literature reviewer knows those things because it's in the literature. So you have to bring the reviewer from a point where the reviewer knows to reviewer doesn't know. So that is very important, that the last bit funneling through this part is where the reviewer doesn't know. That part you have to clearly mention, that part, because that is where the winning part of your research proposal. Because that part, if it is not clear, because you can see initially it was very broad, you know, it funneled down to a smaller funnel where it filters to a place where the reviewer doesn't know. That is where the gap analysis is. This is where you will tell, this is the gap that I'm going to fill this from your research proposal. It's very, very important, that aspect. Yeah. So funnel point is your purpose. The purpose can be framed as a research question or hypothesis. So basically, when you come to the funnel point, you have created your hypothesis. You have created your problem statement. So it is concise, one sentence. That is, you can include the solution to your problem also. So it's your purpose is, when you do the literature search, it funnels to this to get you the problem statement. So it's very important that you get the references. You know, try to get peer reviewed top-notch journals. You know, we have a lot of journals like, you know, very uncreditable journals. We have, when you look at a journal, go to the indexing first and see where it is indexed, whether Scopus is indexed, or Science Citation Index, expanded, and the impact factors, if it is relevant. You know, some fields, impact factor is not very important, because I have seen some of the best mathematics journals, impact factor is not great because there are many readers are there. So that is the reason. For example, if you take the aerospace engineering, also the impact factors are, the best journal have impact factor like 3 or 4. So impact factor is one thing, but it's important that the indexing is very important, whether top indexers are picking up these journals. So those are very important. And also to concentrate on last 5 years. And within the literature review, the advantage that I will tell you what we had in our mega grant was some of the literature that were our own literature. You know, when you cite your own literature on a research proposal, in a research for a competitive grant, the reviewer knows you have some sizable background work you have done and it is under your belt. So that means this person has some work already done and look into positive. So better you have something. As a young researcher, you may not have anything, but it's very critical when you go up in the ladder, you try to create a platform. That is why every time I tell our young people, you design your unique field of study. You conquer on that field. You master on that field rather than going into X, Y, Z, A, B, C, D. Whenever you see some good research talk, you go and do that research. Another research talk, you go and do that research. Another research talk, then you don't have the identity onto you. You create your brand. It's very important, branding. So this person, X person, okay, branding, okay. For example, if you take me, okay, nanotechnology, material science, like that, you know, that branding is very important. So it will take 20 years to brand yourself. You are still 30. When you come to our age, you can have a brand. So everybody will look for your proposals in a more positive note. So you have to distinguish between the review versus primary literature very carefully. Review is okay to cite, but it's very important you cite the primary literature, because very important those aspects. So then plagiarism, you know that now we have the Turnitin in place. Plagiarism, you should avoid cut and paste. Even paraphrasing, we should stop. If you paraphrase, the even Turnitin will not pick up, but it's not a way to do a proposal. So you try to write by yourself. With plenty of mistakes, that I'll give you how to correct those plenty of mistakes in a very short period of time. Yeah. So purpose is clear. Funnel point is your purpose. You have you have created the purpose here. This is where you filtered your purpose. And the purpose can be framed as a research question or hypothesis. Your research hypothesis concise leads directly to aims and objects. That will lead to more bullet points. You know, purpose, and which is a concise statement. It boils down to now few bullet points where you have maybe 5 to 10 objectives. So that you can have short but general statement of intent, you know, aims, you know, objectives. You have specific statements for your aims, how you achieve those aims using these objectives. So it's very important. So I will not take much time on that. So then you have to concentrate your methodology, what you are going to do. That means your instrumentation, infrastructure, study groups and ethics, access to samples, data analysis. These are very important. If you have statistical analysis in your data set, say for example, if you are doing chemistry, how do you contact a statistics department? If you need a specialized knowledge, you bring that person up front, not the place where you want that person. You know, up front you bring him. You are a part of this project. You're a collaborator of this project. You know, I'm again advising you, you can get multi-author papers that is good for your science citation and your H-index. Your multidisciplinary approach are very recognized. You go to my Google Scholar or Professor Rohini's Google Scholar, every paper we publish with Professor Preeti also. Our papers have about 7-8 authors because everything that we are not our core competency, it is very important. It is very important you have a core competency. You write the proposal on your core competency. The core competency determines by your training. If you don't have any hands-on training, either through your PhD or through your postdoctoral studies, you don't start a project because you can't mentor a student if you don't have that one. It's very important when you mentor. Say, for example, if somebody come and ask us, how do we prepare this nanoparticle? But there are problems there and so on. If we have not prepared nanoparticles from our hands on a bench, how do we advise? So it is very critical that over a period of time with accumulation experience, you can do it. But as a young researcher, start with what your PhD competency, what your PhD or the postdoc or any other competency where you have a strong platform to guide the students. Otherwise, when the student come to you, because your core competency, you can't have a collaboration. Core competency you must have. The collaborator brings the other, like the statistical analysis or mathematical modeling or NMR spectroscopy or the transmission electron microscopy. We collaborate with Slintec for transmission electron microscopy for analysis, X-ray photoelectron spectroscopy. We collaborate with University of London. Like that, you bring people. Well, if this is designed in your methodology designing part, your collaborators and so on. Justify your method of choice, show you understand the principles, prove feasibility of your study. Experiment design is very, very important that you have. That doesn't mean that you have to have a concrete one experimental design. There is a room for you to change. That's not a problem. It's understandable because you can't do it, but your framework of experimental design have to be very, 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 very methodical. So it's the last part, Preeti. I'll take 2 to 3 minutes to explain. This is a very important part, the timeline, the project management.
It's okay, Nalin, take another 5 minutes.
Okay. So my dear student, I mean, you are my colleagues, but most of you are a department also. I have about three senior people are my research students, you know. But this is very critical, you know, this after this experimental design, you know, timeline is very important. So, you know, where there's something called the Gantt chart, you know, I know people people design Gantt chart. I will show you a typical Gantt chart. If I have, this is a typical Gantt chart, you know. You take all your projects. I'm sure other people have designed much more better Gantt charts. You know, there are Gantt charts you can go, this is monthly, quarterly, and it's planning from here to here. What are you planning?
Yes, go ahead. There is a question, Nalin, that you can answer.
Yes.
Someone is asking what the best number of investigators added to a proposal.
Okay, it's a good question. There is no rule of thumb or any hard and fast rule on number of investigators. You know, it's depends on your requirement. For example, where the Rohini is the principal investigator, myself, and we had about 7 investigators on that 50 million grant, you know. So that means when you don't just add the investigator sake of adding, everyone has a role to play, you know. Everyone has a role to play. I will tell you their roles in the future. So the investigators, maybe you can write single author proposal. Nowadays, it's very difficult if it is experimental based one single author. Maybe 3 to 4 is acceptable, 2, 3 acceptable. You know, even university grants you can write on your own because those are small grants for as a startup grants, you know. So there is no hard and fast rule on the investigators, but it all depends on the objective of the research grant. NRC specifically say 50 million grant, they prefer many investigators, many projects within one grant. So that's a but if it is a university 5 lakhs grant, you can write even by your own. You don't need any collaborators for that. You know, all depends on the funding body's requirement. Okay, so Gantt chart is like this typical Gantt chart. This is a not. This shows you are not planning properly. This is a poor Gantt chart. You know, these are if you give a 5-year project with this kind of Gantt chart, you will find it difficult. That is why I put this idea called project management. You know, I use a software called Microsoft Project. You know, even Excel is capable of getting a good Gantt chart. But there is a computer software, Microsoft Office has that package, but you pay extra, and that is expensive. I don't think we have that one. That is called the Microsoft Project. Microsoft Project gives you the project management, because this experience I got it from SlainTech, because SlainTech Nanotechnology Institute, we have the project management workshops, and we train our scientists to do a project in a given time, and troubleshooting, all these things are included in the project management. Simply, I will show you Gantt chart of our mega grant. You can see how details of the mega grant Gantt chart. Receiving the grant, to calling quotations, receiving quotations, evaluation of quotations, ordering chemicals, receiving chemicals, delivery of instruments, hiring scientists, location of lab space. You know, that time we didn't have a lab. So location of lab space, 10 days, arranging the lab, mine apparatus and chemicals, start work using existing human resources, hiring first scientists and scientists days, 1,460 days, that is 4 years planning. Then the scientist wants roles, HIP synthesis, 180 days she has to do. So each and everyone is connected to each other, you can see. From the arrow, you can connect it. If one shifts by 7 days, everything shifts by 7 days. So you have to be very careful on, so the project is not going to, so if there is a total shutdown for 3 months, so the project management addresses that, then we can talk, we can communicate with the funding body. So the next one, you can see more. Scientist one, roles are given, the days are given, from start to finish given, and this will go on till 4 years. I have cut and pasted only a little bit. And scientist two, 1,460 days, and the scientist three, 1,460 days. So we hired 3 scientists, and 1,460 days work was given. And all these things are given as key performance indicators, KPIs, to the funding body. So they evaluated us every year against these things. So if the Gantt chart gives you every year what we are going to achieve. So that is what the project management is. You know, it's not, I think the a big factor for winning that grant, I consider this is the project management Gantt chart, which spanned for about 6 pages of our Gantt chart. That's a real project management Gantt chart. So you don't need this kind of thing if it is a small grant. But Excel, if you go to Excel, you can really elaborate you know, each and for example, if you go to this Gantt chart planning, what are you going to plan? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Then January starting, then you go by weekly, and then you go weekly and you explain your Gantt chart in detail. How many people are involved? Research, design, implementation, follow. This is a Gantt chart I downloaded from the Google. But anyway, this is not a good Gantt chart. This is good for an office purpose, you know, but this is not good for a research purpose, because research means that you can see hiring scientists, we have put 30 days, you can see, you know, from November 1st, 2017 to like that, you know, January 11th to February 21st, 2017. That's a hiring period, 30 days we have put to hire. So these 30 days, what we did was contemplate only on hiring, but there are overlaps. You can see there are overlaps. The other things are going to overlap that period. So you can work on other things also. So there are overlaps are taken care of, and interconnectivities are taken care of. You know, you can create milestones, deadlines, progress, everything you can create within the Microsoft project. So my advice is to go to Microsoft project if you are going to manage a big project, but otherwise you can go with the Excel with a proper project management. So then it's very important, the budget, research cost. You can't have unaccounted money. Our 50 million now, our scientist told now, we have 1 year to go. We have spent about 45 million. We have about 5 million left. So we have consumed all. So that means it's very important that you budget yourself. You know, it's very important. How to bring new technologies. We have brought 17 million new instrument. We have brought 11 million instrument. Procuring time, quotation time. Don't give excuses, our college house excuses, our financial department excuses. You anticipate those delays, because there are procurement procedures, there are TEC approval, there are TEC committees. Then if it is a major equipment, you have to get the department procurement committee approval. I'm sure Verangi will talk about these things in detail. So you need those times. You have to confirm in one committee, you have to confirm those minutes, you have to go to another committee. It will take 4 to 5 months. You know, that is very important. You know, those, you keep that time in your proposal rather than giving excuses that, you know, the I can't deliver the project because of this delay, that delay. That means you have not planned. You have to anticipate. If you live in this system, you know where the delays are. That is not because there are problems. This is the system where checks and balances have to be there when you the budgeting purposes, because not because we are rogues, but it is the practice, because of the audit problems, we need to address those issues very clearly in our proposal. Then you have to give the outcomes, measurable outcomes like a PhD or MPhil and a patent or a paper, and qualitative outcomes as well. So this is what my last message, revise and edit, backup proposal every day. Don't keep it for the last minute to print out, get the print out. You know, the Murphy's Law, you know, good, lot of time proposals, the Murphy's Law work. When you try to print out, the proposal doesn't work. You know, that's a real scenario. You know, if something, the hard drive is corrupted or the flash drive is corrupted. So back up your proposal every day, always print on a paper. Don't edit your proposal on the screen, edit on a, I'm a conventional person, but this is the advice given by the MIT also. Get your proposal on the paper and edit. Use standard font, number your pages, read out loud and see there's a problem. So there is a commitment that you need to write the proposal. The common pitfalls to avoid, forget to include table of contents. So those are, you know, all our generic problems that you will see. You can go through my presentation again. Don't rely on your supervisor. If normally our students, you know, our PhD students, we tell them to write proposals. We don't write proposals now. You know, we polish the proposal when they write. You know, it is very important when you come to the PhD level, they start writing their own proposal, because we have gone through that mill. We have been PhD students, we have been postdocs, we have been the initial early career researchers, we have written proposals, and now we are not going to write proposals for our junior people. They have to write. Our PhD students have to write. They know our PhD students, about 10 PhD students, they are trained to do it. I can see the Umayangana, Shanika, Veromi all joined today. They are about to graduate with their PhDs. So improving your odds, start with an outline, read approved proposals, and you proofread, you do whatever you are, it's very, very, if it is a university grant, there is a chance the young researchers will get, but outside grants, there is a huge competition. So you have a mentor, you have a senior person to go through your proposal, get the approval of the mentor and get his comments, get his, ask him to read it through and give the comments for the proposal. And it's very important that you have a mentor for, we are very happy to, help young people. I mean, it's our satisfaction. So evaluation of proposal, that's for the reviewers. We'll look at the aims and objective, whether it was achievable, rationale is reasonable, and the scientific design justified. That those are the three that we will, as a reviewer, will look into that. So with that content, I think I will wind up, Preeti. I think there are other speakers.
Yeah, just a minute. Nalin, don't
go away. I covered, yeah. Okay, sure.
Nalin, just before you.
I think I have covered, Sure.
Two questions. One is, in the case of putting a realistic timeline, if it's kind of long, will that negatively impact the proposal?
Yes. You know, it all depends on the money that you spend. I would say, because the granting bodies normally give you the timeline. They tell you. We have no control of the timeline. Like the university research proposal, you tell 1 year. NSF NRC competitive grants, they tell 3 years. If the NRC mega grants, they tell 5 years. So you have to plan for that 5 years. My point is, you don't exceed unnecessarily that time. That is poor planning. That is what you have to remember. Now, Preeti, when you give 1 year grant, a researcher can't come and tell, madam, I need another 6 months. That is poor planning.
One last question, Nalin. What is the best order of authorship in a research paper or a proposal?
What is that?
What is the best order of authorship?
That is again, Preeti, depends on the granting body and the journal. Like the ACS journal, sometimes ACS journals start with the introduction and straight away go to the results and discussion, and the experiment will come later.
No, I don't think you got my question. Order of authorship.
Okay. All right. It's all depend on the ethics of our research. It's all depends on the ethics. My method will not work for the other people. Some people put alphabetical order, which I don't endorse because that is not a clear method.
Yeah.
Normally, if it is a PhD project, the first author is always our project's first author is the PhD student. And the author contribution then goes down 2, 3, 4 like that. And we normally go at the last stage as the corresponding author with the asterisk. That's when you go to the senior level. But say you have 5, 6 collaborators, say for example, I have my proposal. I have my PhD student. Say for example, one example. I have one PhD student. Say I am the only supervisor inside, and then I have 4, 5 collaborators. I can do this way also. I can do first author my PhD student, second author myself, and the other authors at the end with the least contribution. Mm-hmm. Or I can say first author PhD student, all other authors I put front, and I go at the last. As with the asterisk, when you get the asterisk into you, the place is immaterial. This is created in the Sri Lankan system because of these awards and the promotion schemes. That is where, because I am the person, my advice is, because CBCD awards, if you look at Preeti, they will look into the order of authors. First author, second author, third author, they give marks 20, 15, and like that, So normally I don't endorse that kind of a thing, because we normally go at the end with the asterisk, because that's a world acceptable standard when you are a group leader. you know. But if you are a starting researcher, your asterisk is maybe you are student first, undergraduate student, you are second, like that, you know, there is no hard and fast rule on authorship order, but authorship order is the depending on the contribution. First author is the most contributed, second author, a lot of Royal Society journals, you have to give the contribution percentage, then you have to justify the author order. So it's all subjective. And I have seen some senior people put their asterisk as the first author, which I don't endorse.
Okay, right. Thank you so much, Naleen, for that.
No problem.
Extremely comprehensive and very solid presentation. I think everybody learned a lot. And so hats off to you. Thank you so much.
And thank you, Preeti, for organizing this. And there are about 144 people. And you have done a great job. Thank you, Preeti.
Fantastic. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, everyone. If you have any questions, you can visit the department and ask questions. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Moving on. We have a very special person as the second speaker. We have our very own senior assistant, Bursa. Just a minute.